Major funding for KPBS Evening Edition has been made possible in part by Bill Howe Family of Companies, providing San Diego with plumbing, heating, and air restoration, flood and remodeling services for over 40 years. Call 1-800-BILL-HOWE or visit billhowe.com. And by the Conrad Prebis Foundation, Darlene Marco Shiley, and by the following. And by viewers like you. Thank you.
A big shakeup in San Diego's Republican Party. Thank you for joining us. I'm Maya Trabulsi. The chair of the party abruptly resigned last night after an inner party squabble over the endorsement of a candidate for the state's assembly. KPBS reporter John Carroll talked to two political experts.
The news of Paula Witzel's departure as chair of the San Diego County Republican Party was first reported by La Prensa San Diego. Publisher Art Castaneda says things started to unspool for Witzel last week when the party's executive committee took up a motion to rescind the endorsement of Andrew Hayes in the race for the Assembly District 75 seat. Witzel wanted to give the endorsement instead to longtime Republican activist Carl DeMaio. The effort failed.
On Thursday, the chair of the party, Paula Witzel, declared that the endorsement of Hayes had expired after the primary, so they'd have to hold a new endorsement. And that's what they did last night. But before that meeting, Paula Witzel resigned. When they took up the motion last night, the entire central committee voted to keep the endorsement of Hayes.
I see three competing hypotheses for what drove the resignation of Paula Witzel.
Carl Luna is professor emeritus of political science at San Diego Mesa College.
Could be the local party has enough people in it saying, we're never going to win in San Diego. We're MAGA far to the right, as Carl DeMaio would take us. So it could be an effort to get back to center.
Or, Luna says, it could be part of a power struggle within the party's central committee to take control. Or there's option number three.
A lot of people just don't like Carl DeMaio.
Both Carl Luna and Art Castaneda's are steeped in politics. Luna as a teacher, and Castaneda's, who has run many campaigns and used to be chair of the San Diego Democratic Party. They both acknowledge that these party machinations are inside baseball, but both also say it's important to have two healthy parties that help their candidates up and down the ballot.
If it draws too much attention away from their operation to get other Republicans in smaller offices, school boards and city councils and mayors, because there's a fight at the top of the ticket with Carl and Hayes, it could distract them from what their core principle should be.
It's important to have two competitive parties, both in San Diego and in the state. I mean, right now you have Democratic hegemony after years of Republican hegemony. When you don't have to worry about the other party, you can be sloppy with your own policymaking.
Luna says party central committees used to be places where people went to get some experience and then go into public life. Now he says they're places where political machines are being built. Depending on one's perspective, that may or may not be a good thing. John Carroll, KPBS News.
Reports of anti-Muslim hate incidents and discrimination in the U.S. have hit a 30-year high following the October 7th Hamas attack in Israel. That is according to the Council on American Islamic Relations, or CARE. KPBS reporter Katie Heisen heard from San Diego Muslim leaders about the local impact.
8,061. That's how many complaints of anti-Muslim hate incidents and discrimination CARE received nationwide last year. Nearly half in the final 3 months alone. They say that number is underreported due to fear. And still, it's a bigger spike in complaints than after former President Donald Trump's travel bans. The incidents range from physical and verbal assaults to discrimination in education, employment, and immigration. 45 of those reports came from San Diego County, including vandalism of a local mosque in the days following the Hamas attack. SDSU student Mohammed Erekat says the city has not felt safe.
We have seen our mosques being targeted. We cannot even pray without armed security. Many do not even feel safe going to places of worship anymore. They do not feel safe gathering with their communities.
San Diego City College professor Mona Al-Sarami says college staff wrote a resolution asking district leaders to affirm their free speech right to voice solidarity with Palestinian people.
Our faculty who were voting on the resolution were flooded with anti-Palestinian, Islamophobic emails urging people to not vote in support of the resolution.
The Anti-Defamation League also reports a local rise in anti-Semitic incidents last year. The city of Lemon Grove passed a ceasefire resolution. San Diego City and county officials have yet to follow suit. Katie Heisen, KPBS News.
All right, let's look a little further ahead to tonight. We are dropping down to a low of 53, and it will be clear. And I am happy to say that we just continue on this good weather trend over the next few days. But all good things must come to an end. We are tracking changes as we head into the weekend. We'll break those down for you coming up.
San Diego is not doing enough to account for the money it spends on homeless programs. That's one of the conclusions of a report from the state auditor's office. KPBS reporter Thomas Fudge has the story.
The state auditor released a report that drilled down on the homeless programs of two cities, San Jose and San Diego. The report said San Diego spent $218 million on homeless services over the past three fiscal years, yet it could not fully account for its homeless spending because it had no central spending plan. The audit criticizes both cities for transitioning most homeless people to temporary housing, not permanent housing. They say about 40% of people leaving temporary housing end up back on the street. In a letter to the auditor, San Diego staff said the city does maintain spending plans for homeless services, but not in a central location, and they will correct that. The city agreed with the need for more permanent housing for the homeless, but said, quote, resource constraints have prevented them from creating and implementing a plan for such housing.
What gender do you identify with?
The last point-in-time count of San Diego homeless in 2023 showed a total of 6,500 homeless people in the city. Thomas Fudge, KPBS News.
A highly used safe sleeping site will soon be getting more funding to stay in operation for unhoused people. The San Diego City Council voted to keep the site on 20th and B in Golden Hill open for 6 months longer than was originally intended. The site will soon be at maximum capacity, and the money will be used to fund more staff, food, and other resources for the site.
People want to be in these sites, and they prefer them over shelters for many different reasons. Some people prefer shelters, but many people would rather have their own privacy.
The vote increases the funding by nearly $488,000, which would keep the safe sleeping site in operation through June. Del Mar has the full support of the county to explore affordable housing options on the state-owned fairgrounds, but housing advocates say the city needs to do more. KPBS North County reporter Tanya Thorne has the update.
In a unanimous vote, the County Board of Supervisors passed a resolution to support affordable housing units on the Del Mar Fairgrounds.
That motion passes unanimously with all supervisors who are present voting aye.
The vote came after the City of Del Mar and the Fairgrounds Governing Board agreed to explore the options, if any, to build affordable units on the grounds.
Providing space for 61 affordable housing units is no small task for an event center like this one, particularly doing so in a way that doesn't impede our master planning efforts. So we don't yet know if affordable housing will really work here. But what we do know is that we'll never get anything done if we don't start somewhere.
It could take 2 years to determine whether the plans on the fairgrounds are feasible. And housing advocates fear Del Mar will once again fail to comply with state housing laws.
They're 3 years into this cycle, which started 2021, and they have yet to produce a single affordable unit.
Sahad Assad is with the Yimby Democrats of San Diego County, a grassroots organization that advocates for more abundant housing throughout the region. He says Del Mar should be taking a multi-approach to fulfill their housing compliance.
I think the residents would definitely be more supportive of the fairgrounds, but if it takes until 2030, then they're not doing their fair share that other cities nearby are already making progress on. So it's important to consider other opportunities.
Seaside Ridge is the other housing project submitted to the City of Del Mar. It's a 259-apartment complex on an ocean bluff with 85 units deemed affordable. But that project is held in litigation with the city and sitting at a standstill.
Number one, we have rejected their application because it's incomplete. They've not created a complete application. Number two, the number of affordable housing.
The Fairgrounds project could be 100% low income. The Seaside Ridge project breaks down to 42 low income units and 43 moderate income. In a statement, a spokesperson for the development said, finally, Del Mar has stopped dragging its feet and is at least talking about affordable housing. But whether these talks actually lead to anything is anyone's guess. If Del Mar was at all serious about meeting its state mandate, they would approve the ready-to-go Seaside Ridge project. The supervisor's vote on Tuesday does not open any funding for the study of housing on the fairgrounds, but does represent support on a county level. Tanya Thorne, KPBS News.
I'm Amna Nawaz. Tonight on the NewsHour, Arizona's Supreme Court upholds a Civil War-era abortion law, effectively banning the procedure in the state. That's coming up at 7 after Evening Edition on KPBS.
The Grossmont Union High School District is ready to transform more of its campuses into community schools. The district has been given a $7 million state grant to expand programs like the Career Technical Education Pathway at El Cajon Valley High School. The welding class curriculum prepares students for professional jobs right after graduation. And for the past 2 years, El Cajon Valley has been a successful model of a community school, offering resources that include job training, mental health support, and other help for our students outside of classroom time.
The community schools are designed to improve student engagement, family engagement, family participation, improve attendance, and improve academic achievement.
The grant money will be used to create community centers at other high schools in the district, starting with Mount Miguel and Monte Vista. El Cajon Valley has developed a significant restaurant service pathway, with many students obtaining jobs in the local hospitality industry. President Biden is racing to enact a new student loan forgiveness plan ahead of the election this November. He announced his new plan yesterday, speaking from the battleground state of Wisconsin. Julia Benbrook has the details.
I'm proud to announce 5 major actions to continue to relieve student debt for more than 30 million Americans.
A new push from President Joe Biden to fulfill one of his 2020 campaign promises. The president traveled to Wisconsin on Monday, a key swing state, to unveil the details of his new student loan forgiveness plan.
Too many Americans, especially young people, are saddled with unsustainable debts in exchange for a college degree. It's not just a drag on them, it's a drag on our local economies.
The new plan will impact people who have balances bigger than what they originally borrowed due to interest, and those who qualify for forgiveness under existing programs but have not applied. It will also assist those who began repaying their debts at least 20 years ago, those who enrolled in so-called low financial value programs, and those experiencing financial hardship.
And over the coming months, the Department of Education will propose and then implement these plans.
This is Biden's second attempt to implement broad student loan forgiveness. The Supreme Court struck down his first plan last summer. Several conservative-led states and groups sued his administration over the first program, arguing the executive branch had overstepped its authority.
The Supreme Court blocked us, but that didn't stop us.
The Biden administration has already canceled student loan debt for about 4 million people, mostly using existing programs. That's more than any other president.
The new proposals must still go through a public comment period. Then after reviewing those comments, the Department of Education will publish the final version of the rule. It's a process that could take months and will likely face new legal challenges. Reporting in Washington, I'm Julia Benbrook.
SAG-AFTRA, the union representing Hollywood actors, is looking to write protections against the use of AI into California law. The union is pushing a bill which would require detailed consent for the use of digital replicas, and that includes replicas used in audiobooks, video games, product endorsements, and concerts. A separate bill also asks studios not to put actors who passed away in films without consent from their families. The April 15th federal tax filing deadline is less than 1 week away, but those looking for last-minute tax tips on social media may not always get the best advice, according to the IRS. Karen Kafa takes a look at some of the red flags.
From budgeting to student loan payments, the hashtag FinTalk has exploded on TikTok.
It really just shows how many people are looking for that personal finance advice, how to save their paycheck, how to spend their paycheck, especially during this time of year, how to file taxes.
Brad Messner of the National Association of Tax Professionals and a professor at the University of Pittsburgh says social media can give voice to some helpful sources for tax topics, but not all have the same credibility and expertise.
In a lot of cases, there's a lot of intricacies and nuances. So there is no way in a 15-second or even in some cases a 30-second or 3-minute clip to explain all of the details around the topic.
The IRS said this week bad information on social media, including schemes like misusing W-2 forms to scam a bigger refund, can lead a taxpayer to big trouble. Nick Molney, managing editor at CNET, says users should always do their own research.
The fact check that you always want to put into place, make sure that you know the basics and that you're not just following someone's potential get-rich-quick messaging that may or may not even be true.
After all, Messner says it's the individual filer who's held accountable for that tax return.
When you submit that return or when you sign that return, you are ultimately responsible for it. And if anything comes into question, just the response of, oh, well, I saw that on TikTok, is not really a valid response in the terms of an audit.
In Washington, I'm Karen Kafa.
Well, let's start you off with the big picture with your weather headlines. The warmth, number one on our list, continues through Thursday. So we get to hang on to it for a little while longer. And while we have the warmth, it's going to be staying dry as well. I think that's a win. Though, as we head into the weekend, the pattern is going to change. We are going to turn wet as we head into the weekend. And also, that's when we're going to see that cool down as well. Tonight, though, looking out across the county, Oceanside, you're at 47 tonight. San Diego dropping down to 53 again. Now, Ramona, you're at 46. And Borrego Springs, 53. And Mount Laguna, well, you're dropping down to a low of 40. Like I said, Wednesday, not looking too shabby here. It is still going to be warm here across the Southwest. And if we look at where our highs go, the numbers don't lie. I mean, we're at 72 in Oceanside. Similar story up and down the coast. Ramona, you're hitting a high of 80. And Borrego Springs, well, you're in the 90s. And Mount Laguna, really not doing too bad either with a mild high of 57. Now, I do want to take you over these next few days to kind of show you that cool down I've been talking about, right? Enjoy Wednesday. Enjoy Thursday there along the coast. We are going to start to cool down as we head into Friday with a few of those low clouds breaking. It's not a bad day by any chance, but the chance for showers returns just in time for the weekend. I know, perfect timing, not 68 for the high on Saturday, and we're going to drop down to 66 there by Sunday. Further inland, well, you'll also see that dramatic drop in the mercury. We're at 80 on Wednesday, 79 Thursday. By Friday, you're down to 70. And in the weekend, well, you're in the upper 60s, and that's when those showers do return. As for the mountains, it's a similar story. We're staying in the 50s there throughout the middle of the week, mid-50s even. But by Friday, we're down to the low 50s, and we're in the 40s again as those winds are going to start to pick up this weekend. As for the deserts, yes, you're warm today. Wednesday with a high of 91, 92 on Thursday, but then we drop. We're going to drop down to the 80s heading into the weekend, even with the chance for a shower. I'm not going to rule it out with a high of just 78 as we head into Sunday. For KPBS News, I'm meteorologist Bree Guy.
A San Diego biotech company is putting a new spin on how to talk about people's fight with ALS. IX Cells Biotechnologies in Scripps Ranch is sending a team of cyclists to Death Valley to spark conversations about the technologies that they use and how they can be used to find a cure for ALS. ALS is a disease that affects the nervous system. The president of the company says it's important to recognize people are fighting the disease all over the world.
We are very close to the finish line to find a cure for these diseases. So that is the message we're trying to deliver. If you remember, 10 years ago, we had ice bucket challenge, right? Mm-hmm. At that time, they're causing a lot of awareness in the, in the public, but there's no any cure. Nothing happened in the past 10 years, but things starting to change.
IXL's Biotechnologies works with young patients, mostly on rare diseases that impact the brain. The bikers will travel 400 miles over a 9-day span. San Diego County ranked in the top 10 in the country with the most people living with Alzheimer's disease, according to the Alzheimer's Association. The disease is the third highest cause of death for U.S. adults over 80. While new drugs offer hope, KPBS health reporter Heidi DeMarco tells us that their benefits may not be widely accessible for all.
My dad, Ricardo, was from Guadalajara, Mexico, and he immigrated here when he was about 17, 18. And my mom, Virginia, her dad is from Zacatecas, Mexico.
Patricia Hernandez has been tirelessly caring for her parents for nearly two decades, a journey that has taken a toll emotionally.
So having two parents diagnosed with dementia is devastating. And they were not diagnosed at the same time. My mom's diagnosis came first.
The family had no history of Alzheimer's. Patricia initially thought her mother's symptoms were a natural part of aging.
I knew she was losing her memory, but I didn't know that eventually I'd find out it was an official diagnosis for dementia. About 5 years later, my dad's diagnosis came.
Her father died in 2021 from Alzheimer's complications.
My dad, his Alzheimer's progressed faster than my mom's. And so she's digressed in her abilities very slowly. Friends and family were telling me, I can't believe you have two parents that with dementia at the same time.
The number of people living with Alzheimer's and related dementias in San Diego County is set to surpass 115,000 in the next 6 years. New drugs showing promise in slowing its progression offer hope. But will those most at risk have fair access to this new medication?
Yeah. And look, your two sons.
Yeah, those are my two sons.
Yep.
What happened to them? They don't look that good.
By the time Patricia's parents were diagnosed, they were already having hallucinations. The disease progress was considered moderate to severe, making the FDA approval of Leqembi bittersweet.
Yeah, that's very wonderful to hear, and I'm very happy for the people that would benefit for that. But unfortunately, it's bitter because my parents wouldn't benefit from it.
Latinos and blacks tend to be diagnosed at later stages, automatically excluding them from the use of Leqembi. The drug was designed and approved to treat early stage Alzheimer's. Patricia's concerned about accessibility and affordability of the medication, especially for Latinos, who are 1.5 times more likely to develop Alzheimer's than whites. Experts say that health conditions like heart disease and diabetes, which are more prevalent among Black and Latino populations, are known risk factors.
You know, Latinos, you know, a lot of them are recent immigrants that haven't been able to attain as much wealth as people that have had many generations living here. I don't think my family would have had access to that amount of funds to get that medication.
Medicare is crucial for patients hoping to afford Leqembi, which is priced at $26,500 a year, especially for Blacks and Latinos in San Diego. As many as 37% are reported to live on incomes of about $28,000 a year or less. Even though Medicare is picking up the majority of the bill, many patients will still have to pay more than $5,000 annually in out-of-pocket costs. Nelly Hernandez, clinical care coach at Alzheimer's San Diego, says that's still too expensive.
Their budget is going to cover food, expenses, care, transportation, other needs first before having to make that expense. So
Hector Gonzalez is a professor of neurosciences at UCSD. He's leading the nation's largest study on Latino brain aging. He says cost isn't the only barrier.
Invariably, we see people of Latino heritage, in particular people of Mexican heritage, really have limited access to health care. And in order to get into one of these trials, you need a medical diagnosis saying, yes, this person does look like a true Alzheimer's case.
Research shows people with lower incomes or limited English skills have unequal access to diagnostic testing. Gonzalez says education is the key to early detection.
We need to look at our health care systems and say, are we serving those communities? Are we doing the education to let people know this may help you? or not.
And Gonzalez says there's another cause to Leqembi.
What we see amongst Latinos, the vascular type of dementia seems to be most prevalent.
Research suggests that because Blacks and Latinos have a higher rate of vascular dementia, the drug won't be as effective for them. Patricia isn't sure if her parents were diagnosed with that type, but she would have appreciated having more time to spend with them.
But yeah, I certainly would have tried everything to find the money, even to the point where it may have bankrupt us to get that medication, because it's hope. Everyone should have access to hope.
These days, Virginia continues to have some mobility. Most afternoons, you'll find her on the porch, dancing in her chair, wearing red cat-eye sunglasses and lipstick to match.
So one of the main things I always loved about my mom was her sense of humor, and that she's always happy and always loved music.
Patricia uses music to keep her mom motivated and active and to hold on to something she always loved.
And I'm so blessed that during her progression with Alzheimer's, that hasn't been lost.
Heidi DeMarco, KPBS News.
Some terrific reporting there by Heidi DeMarco. And you can find tonight's stories on our website, kpbs.org. Thanks for joining us. I'm Maya Tribulsi. Good night.
Major funding for KPBS Evening Edition has been made possible in part by Bill Howe Family of Companies, providing San Diego with plumbing, heating, and air restoration, flood and remodeling services for over 40 years. Call 1-800-BILL-HOWE or visit billhowe.com. And by the Conrad Prebys Foundation, Darlene Marco Shiley, and by the following. And by viewers like you. Thank you.